Hey everyone, we're going to talk today about treatment for chronic plantar fasciitis pain. Now, first of all, this isn't the primary treatment or the initial treatment. You should first go to our website, do a search for plantar fasciitis guide, and you'll find a lot of actually easy home treatments you can start with and other treatments that are available. But this is for that plantar fasciitis that's just not getting better. Now, first thing we have to look at is the plantar fascia itself. It is this thick ligament running on the bottom of the foot. Inserts an end here into the heel bone. Now, where it inserts is usually about 4 millimeters thick. Now, when this starts to hurt, normally it starts with a condition called plantar fasciitis. That means inflammation of the plantar fascia. But over time, usually over about a month or so, that devolves into a condition called plantar fasciosis, where you start to see thickening of this plantar fascia, some little tears in it, almost think of it as scarring. And if you were to measure it on ultrasound, where that normal fascia is about 4 millimeters thick, anything above about 6 millimeters thick is considered plantar fasciosis. And that's a much more difficult problem to treat in that that plantar fascia is simply no longer healing. That healing process has stalled, and we need to do something to stimulate that healing. Now, there are a couple different ways to accomplish that. The first one is called shockwave therapy. That's using this machine over here. Second one is a process called dry needling. I'll go over both of those, including advantages and disadvantages. Now, first one is shockwave. Now, this is called extracorporeal or outside the body shockwave therapy. In this handle is a little bullet that goes back and forth, and that creates pressure waves that come out the head here. Though that is applied to the heel, and it only takes about 6-7 minutes, and you do it 3 times, 3 weeks in a row, one session, 3 weeks in a row. Physiologically, what happens when you send shockwave through that plantar fascia is 2 things occur. Number one is something called neovascularization, formation of new blood vessels. Second is something called growth factor release, or these are proteins that help stimulate a healing process. Basically, you're taking a non-healing situation and turning it into an acute healing situation. Shockwave has excellent studies behind it, many level one studies, which is the highest level medical evidence on treating plantar fasciosis. It works usually about 70 to 80% of the time. Now, and I'll go over advantages and disadvantages of both these in a second. The second treatment is something called dry needling. And what we do there is we first numb this up, we put a local anesthetic in, and then under ultrasound, we take an injection needle and we poke that plantar fascia multiple times. That causes some bleeding into the fascia. That brings in blood cells, and those blood cells have proteins that again help stimulate a healing process. So many times you're making a choice between which of these you might want to do in order to get that tissue to heal. Now, the advantage of shockwave therapy is it by far has the best studies behind it. There is more level one evidence of shockwave to cure plantar fasciosis than any other treatment out there. So that's number one. Number two, it's for the most part painless. And number three, there is literally no complication. Nobody's ever worse for having done shockwave therapy. Number four, there's no real downtime. The physiologic effect of shockwave is not affected by whether or not you're active. So those are the upsides of it. The downsides are it's slow. It takes about 4 months to see the benefit of shockwave therapy. And it's not covered by insurance. Most areas of the country, you'll pay somewhere between about $400 and $600 total for those shockwave sessions. Now, the advantage of dry needling is that it's a covered service. It's just considered an injection under ultrasound. There's a code we can use for it, and there's not for shockwave. And so most insurances do cover it. The downside to it is the research isn't nearly as compelling. There's far fewer studies, and those studies aren't as well done. There is also a little bit of downtime. We are traumatizing that fascia a little bit. We may be weakening it by perforating it with the needle. And so we usually want you in a walking boot for a week or two with it. It's not absolutely necessary, but there is some slight increase in the risk of a rupture of the plantar fascia. There's no right or wrong here. Most people will start with shockwave simply because it does have the best studies behind it. But other people will start with dry needling because it is a covered service and they'll do that first. And so you can go either way. People that start with dry needling may later go to shockwave if that fails. And I've actually had a couple patients where They started with Shockwave and that did not work, and they later went on to dry needling and it worked out just fine. So there's absolutely no right or wrong way to go, just advantages and disadvantages. If you have any other questions, go to the website. You can do a search for either the Plantar Fasciitis Guide or Chronic Heel Pain. Both of those will give you the information that you need.